I'm still preparing the beginner's video that I promised. A little patience, please, because I had to order a new mannequin. Oh, great. When they send a $2,000 lens, it's completely unprotected. But when it comes to chicken seasoning and a pizza pan, they gotta have extra protection. So that my landlord thinks that I'm buying big stuff. What the hell is this guy doing? So this is a Nikon 45 perspective control macro lens. And we're gonna shoot it at its minimum focusing distance, which is this one, to the letter E. You see E, the first letter. And we're gonna start from the minimum aperture and go all the way, the maximum aperture and go all the way down. Now, this is a very precise lens. So you see here 2.8. Now let's switch it, let's say, to F4. All right, now look in the back where it says. It says 5.3. Now look what happens when I turn the focusing ring. You see that? So we're gonna be using the values that are displayed on the screen as effective aperture. Well, this is the minimum focusing distance of the Distagon. So what you will see in the back screen is this. It actually goes a few millimeters closer, but I don't want to overdo it. So the Zeiss first at F2. Now, who the hell shoots macro at F2, right? Special effects, I guess. And this is a F11. Yeah, a lot more depth of focus. Doesn't go all the way back, but macro lenses from this distance don't go either. This is a big distance to travel for a macro lens because you're up close. You want more depth of focus, move the camera a little further away so that it extends further back. Here I'm just testing them at the minimum focusing distance. And this is F22. I have a little more extension of the focus field to the back, but not significant. And at the same time, I noticed that the diffraction of F22 has stepped in and affected the sharpness greatly. Specifically, F11 is on the left, F22 on the right. And look at the difference. F11, F22. It's a big difference. Diffraction is strong. Because I remember one commentator said once, oh, you know, I'm using F16, F22, no problem with diffraction. You haven't done the test, man. You haven't done comparison shots. So would I use the Distagon 28 as a close-up lens? Absolutely. I will increase the distance from the subject a little bit. I will step a little further away so that the depth of focus increases and covers also the back. And even the sharpness will improve a little bit. Because it's not designed as a macro lens, it just happens to focus closely. And here I'm kind of abusing the secret charm of the lens to focus at a close distance. But you step 5 or 10 inches further back from this distance and you have amazing close-ups with this lens. And now we have the Nikon, which is macro and goes a lot closer to the subject. And at the minimum focusing distance, of course, and wide open aperture, which is indicated as 3.8 over here, of course, you don't have much to work with. And the detail, though, is quite sharp, right? Whatever little you have. This is a F11. And you don't have much still, because you're really close to the subject. But whatever you have, because you chose it this way, is very, very sharp and very nice. But look at how thin it is, your depth of focus. And then this is 21. And then this is 43, aperture 43. It goes really that low. And it covers almost as much as the Zeiss covers at f22. And now we run out of light. I have 7 light bulbs in the room. I don't have a flash, I don't have a strobe or anything strong. Just 7 light bulbs, but we're really close here at f43, and the exposure is 30 seconds to have base ISO. The sharpness, of course, has been compromised by the f43. Diffraction sets in. Now let's compare both lenses at f11. And of course, the Zeiss is on the right. It's a wide-angle lens. It covers most of the subject. This one on the left, the Nikon, we put it a lot closer to the subject and it covers only a small area. Same aperture though. And let's check at the fine detail over here. And we're gonna see that the Nikon is actually sharper, right? Which area are we looking here? All right, let's put them like that. Look at this detail versus this detail. The Nikon is a lot sharper, but the Nikon is designed for that. It's a macro lens. And if you take the Zeiss a little further apart, a little further away from the subject, it's also going to have quite sharp results that are probably going to be the same as the Nikon, more or less. And it's more convenient for close-ups. The Nikon seems to be more convenient for real macro photography. So now we're going to attach this thing, which is very well designed. No matter how you shake it in the box, the glass never touches anything. At any rate, this does not attach all by itself like that on lenses that have a big front element. You need a reduction ring. So we're going to attach it on the Zeiss for now, because it's got a smaller front element, and see what we get. So what happens is that our focusing distance was reduced dramatically with the attachment. But of course, at the same time, we get a lot less than the subject right now. And as a matter of fact, we get a lot of veneering around. So it's kind of like a little circle of what we're getting, kind of magnified. But it's optical magnification, it's not digital. So we're gonna shoot 3 frames here too. So the results are quite comical in the sense that it's basically a magnifying glass, that's what it is. It's a circular magnifying glass. This is RF2. It allows me to get closer, that's what it does. At F2, at F11, and at F11, I got a magnified image, which might help, And at F22, of course, diffraction sets in and it's a lot duller and less sharp over here. But just for the heck of it, because with a little magnifying thing, I got as close as the actual macro lens. So let's compare the Zeiss with the attachment on the left and the Nikon macro on the right, both are F11. And what I can see here from the size of the items in the picture, they're about the same size. So I got at about the same distance, right? And at F11, what do I see here? Let's check that little area that we checked before. What do you guys see? Do you see anything that I cannot see? Actually, a little bit surprising, I didn't expect that. I see a lot more details with a little attachment. Take this hole, for example, and this hole over here. Let me go a little further in so that you guys can see it better. So take this hole and go all the way this way, your path. And those are both the F11. And all of a sudden things, because the focus point is the letter E at all times, I got more extended focus field, which makes things over here sharper, on the Zeiss with the attachment. The actual area that's in focus has about the same sharpness, right? Indistinguishable. But if you go further in, the Zeiss still has more extended focus. You see this, that looks like the internal part of an ear. Look at this with an icon here. It works. Shit, I didn't expect that. It works. Look at this, and it gives me a lot more extended depth of focus. But on the whole image, you get this circle, this funny circle. It's a toy, basically, but it works. So now a final test. The Zeiss with the attachment on the left, without the attachment on the right. Obviously, the image on the left is going to have reduced depth of focus because we moved the camera physically closer to the subject. The attachment allowed us to do so. But by how much are we losing depth of field, depth of focus, whatever you want to call it? Let's make them the same size and compare these two. And as you can see, I don't really lose that much. Let's compare over here. I don't lose that much. I mean, yeah, I have more depth of focus without the attachment. Why? Because I moved the camera further away. So it's not the attachment that caused it. It's moving the camera further away that caused it. But I have sufficient depth of focus with the attachment on the left, especially if you're talking about macro. That's an excellent attachment. When I bought this thing 2 years ago, it was $71. And today Amazon is selling it at the same price, but pretends that it's giving you a discount. Should you buy it? Well, are you shooting macro now? Because if you're shooting macro now and you're so crazy about macro, but you cannot afford the lens, you are already using extension tubes, aren't you? Extension tubes, though, they reduce the depth of focus a lot more. This one doesn't. This is better than extension tubes. Yep, this is better than extension tubes. If you have already extension tubes, it means that you really like macro, and you should probably get it. If you don't shoot macro at least once a month, then it means you don't really care. You just take close-ups for fun, so don't buy it. It's as simple as that. The conclusion is that this is an excellent attachment on the Zeiss 28 and can be even better than the Nikon 45 macro for certain situations in macro. It is much better than extension tubes. Problem is, you're shooting only the center of the image. It's a small circular thing. That's what you're shooting, the image. It's a small circular thing. That's what you're shooting.
Now, girls jumping on trampolines.
God bless you.
Igor, he didn't say that. What you're describing here is correct. You know, that in the snow, you have to be a little on the low side. He said the opposite. He said, open a couple of stops. It's an old tale from the days of film, and it was not accurate even back then. See, this is 0.67, two-thirds of a stop up in snow. Everything is obliterated. I couldn't get any detail out of this image. And this too, terrible. This is what the manufacturer recommends as correct exposure. And I could have gone lower, I should have gone lower. This is the one from which I got the little crop to print. The second topic, to protect the highlights. Well, Nikon has an automatic way to do that, and you end up with this. And when you end up with this, there is no chance of recovering the correct color. I mean, you can recover an approximation of it, but it's kind of dead. It looks like it didn't need its vitamins or something. And there are, of course, different colorations all over the place. Like this one turns to be orangey and stuff. The problem, of course, is if you notice all the way up here in the histogram, you see the blue channel? Look at what the blue channel is going to go through now. Boom, it's going to squish and completely clip. Every pixel is a recipe of three colors. And when I do that, you know, I will still have the original problem of blown up highlights in the back, as you can see. And now I get another problem too. The trees are dead. The color is dead. Okay. And that is why I'm getting so many pictures from yours, when even when the exposure seems correct, or at least the final result, the colors are kind of dead. And you say, that's a $5,000-$7,000 camera? You see, this is the color I was expecting, something like this, I mean, in vibrancy at least. And this is the straight out of camera JPEG from a 2003 pocket, tiny little sensor Canon camera. The exposure is P. I always had this camera on P, which means pretty much automatic, just a different mode. Straight out of camera JPEG, ready to take to Walgreens. And to this day, I have not received from any viewer any files that have the color accuracy of this file, especially skin tones, the red, everything. Straight out of camera, little JPEG from that same camera, PowerShot G5, 2003, 5-megapixel, tiny sensor, little camera, which also had a little embedded flash. Straight off camera JPEG. Now, the other subject that I want to touch with you is these two-thirds of a stopover exposure that you recommend, 0.67. You see the background? The face is with flash. This is the straight out of camera RAW file. The face is fine, it's perfect. But look at the background from the two-thirds overexposure. You cannot fix this. Let me show you why. You go here, if you reduce the exposure slider, what are all these sliders? Color adjusting sliders. Even the exposure slider, it's just adjusting colors. You cannot add light or remove light from an electronic file. It's just color adjustments. You can see from the histogram, and each channel changes separately. And if you go here, you start having a completely unrealistic image. You're not going to see this image in nature. It looks kind of weird. So you go conservatively over here, and then the highlights, even at minus 100, it's still blown. And if you keep doing that, the colors start getting dead and weird. You cannot really fix that. This one, on the other hand, which is only one-third of a stop up, you can fix, especially if you remove those two guys from here. And the face is still good because of the flash. Now, what do you do in this image, for example? I chose to blow the highlights on the top left because I don't care about them. Now, somebody would say, oh, I'm going to measure for the highlights over here, and blah, blah, blah. And then also use the flash for the subject. Now, it's impossible to measure the highlights from the sun because that's practically unlimited. Everything else is going to be pitch black, right? So how are you going to end up? Well, you're probably going to end up something like that, which is particularly ugly. it looks like a weird movie kind of thing, because you wanted to protect the area on the top left. You know, it's not really worth destroying the image, because a couple of highlights that are practically irrelevant to the image are blown in the background or something. Nobody cares about that. It's better to get good exposure on the subject. Unless, of course, your highlight is a huge area in the back or a huge panel or something. For example, good black and white photography is gray photography. You really don't want the whites. White is ugly, completely white, when it occupies large portions of the image and it doesn't print well. But in case like this, you have to sacrifice this part on the top left to get the exposure right on the subject. If you meter the whole scene just from the highlights, everything else is going to be pitch black. And sometimes you even incorporate them in the image as an aesthetic choice, but it's better in this case for them to be slightly gray. Even the snow in the old film days, it was always better to be slightly gray, not white. You want it slightly gray, because white does not print. It's awful on the print.
The M240 came, and about, I think, 1.5-2 years after the M240 was introduced, came the M246, and that was the monochrome version of the M240. So again, like it did...
This is ugly, because it's big. It's a huge part of the image, and it's very white.
What they had done with the M9, they stripped the sensor, that was a CMOS sensor, 24 megapixel. They stripped that for the Bayer filter, and said, okay, here we have a black and white version. And I got this camera, and I remember I went to Munich, I went to Paris, I went around with this camera, and I wasn't that happy with it. And I wrote, I'm not happy with this. I don't like that the highlights tends to just go into a plastic white look. They don't look pretty. I don't like the lighter gray tones of this.
Suspicious. Oh, just as I thought, guys. Gotcha, guys. Oh, yeah. There's like 10 of them.
See, you gotta use flash. Even bouncing it off the ceiling, it's better than nothing. A few notes, since I'm on the topic on ETTR, which was a thing relevant to the old sensors that had a lot of noise in the shadows. A subject that I have analyzed the crap out of it. Destroys micro contrast. Reduces the dimensionality of the image, and after you raise the shadows, you got the ugliest HDR mode images you can imagine, unless you have seen ever grass like that. The main reason, of course, is that most people were doing it incorrectly, because ETTR wants only base ISO, otherwise you're at risk of corrupting the colors severely, and not more than one stop over. 3/4 of a stop, as a matter of fact. Now, why don't the cameras have ETTR in the menus? Because they got all sorts of other image processing abilities, including some proprietary ones. So why don't they have ETTR? They have HDR, they have highlight protection, they have this, they have that. They don't have ETTR, the cameras. Why? Because they don't want the people out there setting the camera in ETTR and then shooting at 5,000 ISO and two stops over. The only purpose of ETTR, the only purpose, was to reduce noise in the shadows. So you were overexposing the image a little bit to reduce noise in the shadows, which was relevant 15 years ago, but it's not relevant today. Modern sensors do not have that much noise in the shadows. So I found a better method. The first two images are ISO 64. The third one is ISO 31. More detail, and more detail in the shadows, readily available. And the noise was less than half of ISO 64. Lloyd Chambers did the same test, reached the same conclusion, that the noise is less than half than ISO 64, and on the D850, the colors were the same. You did not have any shifting colors, although it's a so-called fake ISO. I found that in all conditions, the shadows of the ISO 31 were much better without needing to disrupt the color in post. I tested it on this image, which had a lot of strong highlighted areas, if I find this part, a lot of blown highlights, as a matter of fact, and it was behaving just fine, except, and that's a big one, when I have bright skies in the image, really bad skies with ISO 31, when they're bright and bluish, ISO 64 is better. But when I don't have the sky in the image, when the sky is irrelevant or it's dark, cloudy, and what have you, ISO 31, the way to go, for me at least. I even did low light tests with it, and it was better, much better in noise. The image on the left, ISO 31 versus ISO 64. However, because it's not recognized as a true ISO by software, I recommend that you use it only after you have taken your 64 ISO images and only in landscapes, when you want probably the best out of your sensor. So you have landscapes that do not have bright skies and stuff. After you have taken your ISO 64 images, shoot a couple with ISO 31. You're not losing anything. And then check the results. You may actually end up choosing the ISO 31 images. So these are my rules, generally speaking. The snow 0 or -3. As you say, I agree with you. The other guy was not saying that. The other guy was saying overexposing the snow. Dancers, flash, Canon T2i with the 18-55 kit zoom lens and a flash. Year 2010, all are JPEGs because I didn't know what RAW files were. So I was shooting everything JPEG. One thing though, to be careful with dancers and studios and stuff, is that because of the speed, you cannot really use second curtain flash. You have to use straight flash. And this causes sometimes ugly shadows in the back. But most people don't notice them. The key point is that you can take this JPEG straight out of the camera to Walgreens for prints. Okay? And if you want to be a perfectionist, maybe you give a third of a stop up to this guy in post. Doesn't need anything else. The colors are here. And you cannot replicate this with a really dark image without flash and then raising shadows and doing whatever the hell you want to do. You cannot get those colors. But always be careful of the shadows, as I said. Position yourself in such a way, or keep them away from walls or angles where the shadows are going to be weird, perhaps, because you have to use straight flash. So I pretty much let the camera handle everything. I locked in the shutter speed and I let the camera handle everything else automatically. That's it. How do I look? This file, as a matter of fact, I send it to those guys over email. 6 megabyte file, straight out of camera JPEG. And they made prints, as it was. And it's perfect. For prints especially, it's perfect. Here's again the first one, the tiny little one. In Munich, second curtain flash, he's supposed to be in the shade, natural shot. Tiny little camera, second curtain flash. Because you want it to look natural and not overflashed, both background and subject. Second curtain flash, straight out of camera JPEG. Although the crappy little lens that this camera had doesn't really help much here. However, if we consider this picture and this picture over here, also straight JPEG from the little pocket camera, this is flash. This is against the sun, guys. This is against the sun. And she's in the shade. Now, this is a JPEG. I was shooting JPEGs back then. Let's see what we can do with it. Because you cannot really do that much with a JPEG file. You gotta have the RAW file, right? But let's say we reduce the highlights. You see the sun is right behind. And then we take a linear gradient all the way down to, let's say, here, and we reduce too much over here, probably, and the highlights over here, something like that, right? And in that area, maybe I want the whites a little lower. No, it turns it dead. But at any rate, you're at this point. She's in the shade from this distance. The sun is right behind her, shooting against the light, against the sunlight, and you get this result with a pocket camera made in 2003 with a little embedded flash, which makes me wonder if I had taken this camera and gone to this little competition between these two. Imagine the earthquake in YouTube sphere that the results would have caused. Because these little cameras with a flash are designed exactly for these kind of pictures. Vacation photos. Fill-in flash. Second curtain, you get exactly this picture with these little cameras. That's what they do. That's what you just saw in this video. And without the green skin that I see here, well, if you shoot RAW, you can fix that. See, that's exactly what they do. Second curtain flash. With a little Canon power shot. That's it. Second curtain flash, straight out of camera JPEG, and it even looks more natural this way. So it doesn't look like she's overflashed in the middle of the day. That's high noon. It still looks like she's in the shade. Straight out of camera JPEG, second curtain flash. People would have realized that to take the exact shots that were shown in that video, you just need a point and shoot camera with a flash. No Sony, no GFX, no Nikon, no Canon, nothing. You may only be shooting landscapes. That's a personal preference. But my point with this video is that if you cannot get these kind of results straight out of camera, then you should sell your equipment and get a nice point and shoot with a flash. They're much better nowadays. This is the last time I'm talking about exposure in this channel, except one video that I'm preparing for the very beginners. I've analyzed the crap out of it, and future comments or questions, I'm going to refer them to this video, this segment, and to my playlists. Pedro, yeah, I told you so. Get the SP500. You'll never go back. It's one of the smartest, maybe the smartest flash that Nikon ever made, because it's incredibly intuitive and it's got plenty of power for 99% of things. It's not a supercomputer like the SP5000, but it does its job without you having to set up anything. Do not use the video LED light. don't ever use that again. You're gonna burn it because it doesn't have an internal fan. And also, set it from the back of your camera, the settings on the screen of your camera, as a second curtain flash. You'll be amazed at the results. Now I'm going to move to a different subject by popular demand, which is not photography related. It's political, so if you don't care, just skip it. Because it's going to affect our photographic choices and options as well for the future, and it's quite critical. Snappy Thappy, do you ever believe that what's going on with COVID and the energy price increases are deliberate? I don't know about COVID, nobody knows about COVID, but...
And for me, we weren't kept down by the Ku Klux Klan or tremendous physical brutality the way the Negro was, say, in America. We were kept down by the original geniuses of brainwashing, which was the British aristocracy, who taught us it was ennoble to be poor, and they taught us with the help of religion, it was noble to be poor, and the meek shall inherit the earth.
Well, let's see. The American Presidency Project. Blah, blah, blah. In 2008, Secretary Chu said, somehow we have to figure out how to boost the price of gasoline to the levels of Europe. An American needs to travel about 3 to 4 times the distance than a European to go to his job, the grocery store, whatever. It's because of the way American cities are built. Now imagine this cost. It's going to impoverish about a third of the population, without a doubt. That's the first people it's going to take out. And we all know from statistics, for example, that a 1% uptick in unemployment leads to about 40 to 50,000 deaths. Imagine if 30% of the population has a problem, financial problem, that is even worse than unemployment. This is the way that these people think. They say high gasoline prices will make research into such alternatives more urgent. No, it won't. Because people are not going to have money to invest in such technologies like electric cars, because of all of their money will be spent to buy the gasoline. Now, it may be shocking for some people to admit that most advisors in Washington, D.C. have never actually lived a normal life, have never had a job outside of what they're doing in Washington. They went straight from the university to Washington. They're always under the umbrella of the state. They have absolutely no idea how it is to pay the bills of a household. Now, if you say these things to the supporters of these administrations, they're going to tell you, no, that's just a conspiracy theory. They said it themselves in the Wall Street Journal. But here is a fun test for you. We like tests in this channel, don't we? Ask any modern liberal the following question. Do you want the middle class to become wealthier or poorer? It's not a trick question. It does not have another question following up. No. No tricks, no traps, nothing. Very simple question. And it's a question that requires only one word for an answer. Either wealthier or poorer. That's it. Ask this question. That's when you'll be shocked. Because they're not going to give you a clear answer. None of them. Seriously, none of them. They're going to come up with something like, oh, I want the people to just have the necessities for life, blah, blah, which is pretty much the Soviet way that they didn't even achieve. I want the people this or that. They're not going to give you a clear answer. In most cases, they think that they're going to keep being wealthy, but the rest are going to be poor. What they don't think is that the other ones who will have lost their jobs will come after their jobs, and they will go to the boss and say, whatever this guy is doing, I'm going to do it better, I'm going to work 2 hours more every day, and I want 30% less salary. So the same guy then goes ahead and says, the Stone Age did not end because we ran out of stones. We transitioned to better solutions. Yeah, but nobody abolished the stones. Nobody forbid the stones. The stones were still available for anybody who wanted to still use them. He cannot even form a proper sentence without leaving a ton of holes for a counter-argument. And this is the most blatantly false analogy that I have read in the last 2 months. And then Obama says, oh God, and I supported this guy. I strongly supported him in the first elections because I characterized George Bush a war criminal. And he was. I still believe that. At any rate, he said, I want to invest that money, blah, blah, blah. He invested it in some solar companies, taxpayers' money, and they all went bankrupt. Their CEOs got out rich, though. Typical American developments, right? They also happen under Republicans. Nobody's innocent of that. But yeah, it's 100% intentional. And it's not a secret, even, because they say it out in the open. They're not hiding it. Now, what baffles me is certain class of professionals, such as photographers, who have been hammered by rising costs, and they still vote for the same people. And then they're wondering, why are they bankrupt? The majority of American photographers who use photography as a side gig and or as a main gig, but they are paid with typical checks or cash, nobody files an expense report or a 1099 for them, so they do not pay taxes on that amount. It's under the table money. If we become Europe, my European viewers right now are laughing. Not only will they have to impose a VAT tax of, let's say, 12 or 18% on the client, but it is mandatory receipts, mandatory report to the tax authority. There's no way to escape it, the way the system is structured. So on top of charging their clients more, which means they're going to lose clients, they will also have to pay 30% or more total income tax, federal and state. And that's going to get ugly. 80% of photographers who are still somehow surviving are going to be out of business within the first week. You would think that as freelancers, they would be supporting and voting the side that favors freelancers. but the so-called photographic community are a special kind of stupid.
When most people talk about visiting Stockholm, they usually never speak about the suburbs of the city. In this video, I'm going to show you why that is entirely understandable, because most suburbs of Stockholm are not the most boner-inducing areas of the city, but it is where most people live, and which makes them, I guess, the most authentic parts of the city in ways, the hipster areas of the city, yeah. Because most Stockholmers don't live in Vasastan and own three boats and look like they shit nothing but lobsters and caviar. Most people live utanför tullarna. Maybe they own three cats and certainly don't shit anything from the fish aisle. Maybe some fiskpinnar if there's cause for celebration, you know. So if you want to sort of get a sense for what life is like for the average Swede in a suburb of Stockholm, you should go visit one of these identical suburbs or just watch this.
You see, this is the problem with liberals in the US. They kind of think that they're gonna move to places like the ones shown in the brochures of Scandinavian countries or Northern European countries. As this guy says, that's where the millionaires live. The middle class lives here. That's where the middle class lives. Now the question is, will the photographer have enough income to be middle class? Because 99% of them will not. And as I posted, if you remember in another video recently, a translator saying, well, you need some kind of a side gig as a retiree in Denmark if you want to buy a second pair of glasses or something. When the shit hits the fan over here, it's going to be a spectacle to see. Now, the thing is that when you reach that level, though, you have already gotten used to a system and you can never go back. There is no turning back. Because you cannot even imagine, if one generation passes, you cannot even imagine what the previous system looked like, and it's probably stigmatized by then. Finally, the reasons the US was called the land of opportunity were that you had many good areas with low cost, industrial development, and property rights to immigrants. My parents did not have property rights as immigrants in Germany. We're not here for the food recipes or the weather or the landscapes. What's happening with this administration is that this goes down the drain because of energy cost. And this goes down the drain if you have seen the latest industrial output figures. And the property rights to immigrants are now irrelevant because property also entails a lot of energy usage and a big capital to get into that club. So a lot of talented immigrants are never going to come anymore when they compare things. There's just not that much advantage anymore. And many of those who are here are going to go back to their countries. Who in his right mind will pay Italian cost of living to live in Nebraska or even in California? It's like paying for gold and you're getting shit. These deliberate policies are making the United States a bad deal because it's becoming too expensive for what it offers. But as I said in that old video 2 years ago, the only positive side effect will be that the donations economy will dry out. You're not going to have any more fake gurus accumulating followers on Patreon who send them $5 or $10 so that the guru lives for free. They're going to have to get real jobs. Many services are going to lose a lot of customers. Some people say Netflix lost customers because it was displaying inappropriate movies. That's bullshit. Netflix was displaying inappropriate movies from day one. But when food and gasoline prices are going up, people start cutting all the small little accounts that they don't need. About a month ago, we went with my daughter to the local bookstore, sold them a lot of books that I have accumulated over the years. Some of them I have read, some of them I would never read. We also sold them DVDs, tons of them, that we have watched. We got a total in two trips of $220. They bought the DVDs for 50 cents a piece. Somebody could walk in, buy a DVD for $1.50. Amazon is charging rental for the movie $4. For the same price that Amazon charges for one rental, you can buy two DVDs and a used book. It's only gonna get worse because the people is run by experts now, and by Harvard people. First time in history that the world is run by a cult. Thank God some people still have humor. Will YouTube photography channels still exist? Absolutely. You have inheritances, trust funds, and life insurance proceeds. Many times you see a guy on YouTube saying, so-and-so person died, very close relative. And all of a sudden, within 4 weeks, they go from $4,000 equipment to $20,000 equipment. And they never said what kind of job they do. How do they make a living? And then you have the corporate sponsorships and the affiliated links. The first category, they just want to promote themselves. You can call it crappy entertainment. The second category is really after your money. Do you remember what kind of gear I recommended that you buy in 2021? First, you have to pay off your credit cards because you're losing money every day. The new fees and charges are crazy. But then do not say to yourself, oh, I have no debt now, I'm gonna buy this new fancy lens. That's not you talking. That's a paranoid idiot in your head talking. This paranoid idiot was implanted in your head by all those YouTube channels. Do this instead. That's your new goal. If you're in the US, your debt should be minus $5,000, meaning you have $5,000 in the bank and all your debt paid. Your creativity will skyrocket because you will feel more secure. Among the worst enemies of creativity is underlying stress and insecurity. And even a small amount of debt can cause this. And if you are a gear-based photographer and not a subject-based photographer, well, it's no wonder your pictures are boring. Trying to learn new gear all the time means you're still in the classroom. You're still learning. And by the time you're ready to graduate, you go buy more new gear. So you're always in the classroom. You're afraid to go out, so you stay in the classroom by buying new gear all the time.